So that's when I really, really began to let myself feel that self-attack, actually embrace it and welcome up this deep anger. And initially, I felt anger at being sick. That was the first level I could get to, just pissed off. After all these years, after all that I've done, I still feel sick. I still feel a lack of well-being. And then dropping below that to, is there anything else I'm feeling angry about? And dropping through the layers, it included anger at people in my life, anger at my husband at the time, anger at my parents. All of these I felt through, kept dropping down below that. Anger at God, and then finally, deep, deep anger at the self that I thought I was. And so just perfectly in line with what you were saying. And in that, I felt a discharging of this tension that had been in my system for so long that I just learned to live with. You know, just like this tension in the shoulders and a tension in your stomach and just an overall kind of shaky feeling. The more anger I released, the more calm it became. Because I always thought being calm and peaceful was a matter of calm down, you know, just simmer down, calm down, as opposed to welcoming up that which seems to be the epitome of lack of calm. Welcoming chaotic, very, very stressful, unpeaceful feelings to the surface. And through doing that and embracing that and accepting that, those underlying thoughts and beliefs became very, very apparent. And at that point, I started to get dramatic symptom relief. I mean, I used to just cry myself to sleep because I used to be so physical and so vital, and I could hike up mountains and stand at the top like Rocky and just feel on top of the world. And for years and years, I didn't have the energy to do any physical exercise of any kind and basically just get in my car, go to my office, come back, make some food, relate with a few people, go to bed really early. And if any of you have experienced chronic fatigue, you really start to have a very narrow life because there just seems to be so little energy available. So the energy started to come back, and I had to own, why did I want chronic fatigue? What torqued purpose was it serving for my ego? Because at that point I really got, we're always, without accepting, experiencing what we want on some level. So looking at how I wanted to withdraw, I wanted to not be available. It was my way of saying no to all the obligatory giving that I was doing in my life, all the people-pleasing. And so I had this handy excuse, I can't do it, I'm just too tired. I mean, you certainly understand. How could I possibly say yes? I'm exhausted. And people were very convinced by that. And I got really convinced by it. But as I saw that it was all a means of punishing myself, punishing others, and just on the deepest level, like we were talking about in our expression session this morning, just the outpicturing of the guilt, that's when my heart started to open and I began to feel that, wow, there really is no external cause whatsoever. It has nothing at all to do with anything in the physical. It has only to do with my relationship with myself and my relationship with my feelings. So chronic fatigue was this beautiful gift to me to confront lifelong patterns of self-denial and self-abuse and self-hatred and identifying with that which I am not. And I'm telling the story quickly, but just so you get the realistic sense of it, it took about 6 years to go through this whole internal journey until the energy began to flow back again. And even then, I was still focused on symptom relief. I thought that was the miracle. Oh my God, I got my energy back. Wow, I wanted to shout it to the rooftops. I wanted to write a book about it. I wanted to start to do seminars. You can heal anything. And Spirit showed me another layer that I think we're all really falling into now. That the healing is not the symptom relief at all. That was a byproduct. And what was really healing was the mind misidentifying and adhering to beliefs and harboring repressed feelings that weren't the truth. That was the healing. The body seemed to follow suit, but it really wasn't about that.
So you can see that, you know, we could reframe it from just kind of symptoms to starting to take it underneath a little bit, like, I'm trying to avoid something with the sickness, like she was saying, really trying to avoid the people pleasing. And I think most people can relate to that a bit, like when we're in school, and school starts to get so routine, so methodical, so boring, so intolerable, that all of a sudden, you know, oh, I'm sick today, looks like I get a sick day, right? Andy acted it out with that. That's the happy look of sickness, of, right, like having a joint.
Or no, thermometer.
Thermometer, oh. It depends on which generation you're in. Thermometer or joint. But it's an avoidance there. Or for me, I really did not like to go to church. So I would just kind of wake up in the morning with this just ghastly feeling of being forced to go to church. And so I would just stay in the bed and I would just go round and round and round in my mind about how I did not want to go. It was like I focused my full attention on not wanting to go to church. And then slowly I would work my way into a fever, a pretty good fever. And then once I got worked up pretty good, then I'd invite Mom in and say, come in, I don't feel really well. As I'm under the covers, and she'd say, well, I don't know, we have church today. And then she'd come and say, feel my forehead. Oh, you are sick. Working inside, right?
Yes.
And then, you know, it's like pretty interesting that you go to all that mental work to make yourself sick, to avoid something that I believed I had no other way of avoiding. It wasn't like offered as a choice. Well, what do you think, little David? Do you want to go to church this week? No! No, it wasn't. It wasn't offered. So when you believe you're a child, you see, it's not like the children are helpless. It's just that the mind believes it's a child who's helpless and believes that there's parents out there and there's authority figures out there and it's stuck in a world. And that's self-concept. So the self-concept is so firmly held in place and of such a feeling of being suffocated or trapped that sickness seems like a pretty good option. Like, well, there's one option I can do to get out of going to church, and that's to make myself sick. And of course, people do that in various professions, you know, where they just start to get a real burnout of the job or the career, and then how convenient sick leave or sickness. And it can even be more of a plan of like, okay, I can't really tell my boss that I'm going to quit, or I can't really voluntarily do it, so I'll just make myself sick. Get all the pity of everyone involved, oh, you poor baby. And then if I make myself real sick, that might get me out of the whole thing completely. Mm-hmm. You know, severance pay or some kind of insurance pay. You see, this whole thing is all invented. And, you know, really what we're seeing is sickness is often used as an avoidance to face some kind of issue deeper down in the mind, which really, you know, would be good to put your full attention on. What is that that I'm not facing? What is it that I'm hiding? And it's this causation thing that Noel's mentioning. The basic underlying assumption underneath it is, I've got problems, and they're problems in the world. And I'm going to have to do lots and lots of very complicated things to try to extract myself from a very, very, very tangled mess. It's the way that it seems on the surface. And when you start to say, wait a minute, no, this can't be that way. It must just be an invitation for me to go much, much deeper inside. And if I'm really willing to do that authentically, to go much, much deeper inside, the Spirit will give me the means of support. The people, the symbols, everything I need, if it's such a glorious purpose. And the little chart that she laid out, she was delighted to say, oh, this was like your little chart, your rings. It was very, very similar. It's like what that is, in her sense, the heart speaking, giving her intuitively a map of the mind or a map of consciousness and saying, okay, you've got to get your causation straight. You know, what you seem to have or do or perceive is really the bottom of the line. It's really the end point. It's not the causation at all. And you see how different that is from the typical human belief that, oh, I would be much happier if I didn't have this dad, if I didn't have these symptoms, if I didn't have, you know, that's what much of your life was, thinking, if I just see the right specialist and I can just be lifted from this specific problem, that will make my life so much more easy. And yet, it's just, the ego's like, okay, you find a temporary solution there, it just shifts over here, try this one then. Or try this one, or try this one. It's like a dam breaking loose, and you're running along trying to, with pebbles and stones and clay, to plug the dam, and the water is coming through everywhere. It just gets to be unmanageable. You think, my life is a total mess, it's a wreck. Then you can always turn on the TV and do the comparison thing and say, well, there are people that have their lives together, but my life is a total mess. You know, the dam is breaking on all fronts. And that little piecemeal approach of running up and down the dam and frantically plugging rocks and clay in to try to stop the many holes that are just popping, and you plug a few and 10 more pop open, that's where the depression can come in. That's where people get suicidal, when they have holes just popping and popping and popping, and they still have an ideal that there are these healthy people, well-adjusted people, that are living happy lives, like they, oh, look at the commercials for vacations, there they are going out, laying on the beach towel and vacationing, and the cool breeze blowing by, you know, and all these problems, how can it be? And you can see where it can get projected onto God, it can get projected onto yourself, the body self, and it just won't go anywhere. So that's part of what we've been talking about all along. I can give the metaphysics, but then at some point it just has to be this kind of, this switch to, I am not going to play this game anymore of looking for causes in the world, and believing in causes in the world, and trying to handle an internal problem with all of these externals. I mean, all of us, it sometimes it's the school of hard knocks before we start to be ready, I guess, to hear that we have to look inside. And we really do. It's not just kind of like, well, that's one option in life, to look inside. It's like so important, it's actually crucial that we do that. And that's what we're here for. You know, we're here to facilitate that.